We can hear her though. She's muted.
Oh, you need to unmute Azania.
You know, you think after 2 years, okay, of doing this, you know, you would know to unmute.
That's so true.
Welcome to 2022, everybody. I hope you've had a really good transition over. I hope you're as optimistic as we all are at IBFC. It's a beautiful warm day here in Johannesburg, even though we know it's going to shower like crazy later on. My name is Azania. I'm a co-chair at IBSC with my dear good friend and colleague Magansri. We are a wonderful board of about six people, two guys and four women. I mean, you know, I'm all across the country, Cape Town, KZM, Durban, Johannesburg. So from a board's point of view, I'm just here to welcome. My job is very easy. And I think that I'm not going to speak too much. I'm going to let the conversation happen. So really what we're trying to do here is to promote and highlight the work that our women in the industry are doing phenomenal things. And what better way to kick off the year than to have Bongiwe Selane and Jayan Moodley. Oh my goodness. I mean, game changers in their own rights, cut their teeth doing various projects, as we know. I mean, not only are Jayan and Bongi phenomenal producers, they're also really, really good friends of the industry. You know, they've been there, they're always there with us and for us. And so I'm not really gonna give too much away as to what they've done. I mean, we all know their profiles. I think it's only fair that in the conversation, we allow the conversation to flow. It will be a conversation between three women. Magansri was gonna lead the conversation, but let Jayan and Bongiwe also kind of interject, have their own questions, learn from each other, and hopefully give us some insight. A lot of people look at this as a masterclass. I don't think it is. It really is a conversation among, you know, the elite, in terms of excellence, Black excellence, Black female excellence, as to, you know, what they're doing, where they're going. So I'm going to hand over now to my coach, Magansri, to just let the conversation flow. For me, the biggest thing is let's learn, let's understand. It's not really about, you know, trying to find funding or the normal questions. It's really about who are you, Bongi? Who are you, Jayan? What got you to where you are? What are your passion points? What is it that you, what legacy do you want to leave behind? What are your financial, your management strategies around this? What are your family management strategies around what you do every single day? It's a job. It's something that you chose to do. It's a passion. It's more than a job, actually. And I always joke that the film industry is the one industry that even if you are 65, 70, you still want to make your first film. So there's a certain level of passion that comes with being in the film industry. It's your story. It's creative. So I'm going to, like I said, hand over. Magansri, I know you're going to run this amazingly well, but let's just let the conversation flow. So let's just see what they have done. Tundi, I'm going to like to now just like put on the trailers. Now, we've been through 2 years of unmute, sound. We've gone through 2 years of glitches. So if on your side, the trailers glitch, please understand, it's just the way the world is. Enjoy. Yeah. Thank you for joining us.
Happily ever after real, or just a ruse? Maybe it's just a perfect ending for Cinderella.
Going to be so happy.
This is amazing.
How many carrots is this?
It's a lot.
But for some of us, the search for true love never ends.
What do you say we get out of here?
I'd like that, actually. Just food, obviously. No funny business.
Oh no.
Maxwell's a good guy.
He looks stunning.
He's that perfect picture of stability.
Please put your hands together for the beautiful princess.
He's trying to make up to you, to her.
Yeah, it's too late for that.
You're selling my house.
You're nothing but a liability.
Open the gates!
Hell will freeze over before I allow you to bring Ben 10s in my brother's house.
You really struck gold with Maxwell here.
Everything that glitters is not always gold.
I suck at relationships.
Don't worry about it, me too.
Oh, later.
My brother's estate will be longer.
and I'm here to make sure that every single penny of his does not land in the wrong hands. She's threatened to put me and my children in the streets.
Got to touch it. Connect with the artistic expression, the meaning. It's not a woman, it's art. Same difference, bro.
Exactly what is happily ever after? Maybe it's just a perfect ending for Cinderella.
If you don't know who you are, everyone will tell you who you're meant to be.
Or the beginning of our Sleeping Beauty story.
What time are you guys leaving?
We pick up a few things and then we'll hit the road.
What few things?
It's a surprise.
Just for the two of you.
Forgot something.
What?
Me? It's okay. I won't need it.
My sister.
In-law.
You are beautiful.
Thank you.
I hope one day I get to age as gracefully as you do.
I want to smack her across the face with this racket.
And
the worst part is that Elvis is enjoying every single minute of it.
Can you guys catch nuts with your mouth?
No, but you look like a pro.
What happened?
Men up for us, bro.
As for Peggy, I don't know whether he's calling Shanti or Awanti.
It's contagious, bro.
Yeah.
What did you say?
I said, what you gonna do about it?
See, I wish you want, I must die.
Please, if that's what I wanted, you would be long gone.
Ma?
This is the holiday when we get our husbands back.
Razo, this is the holiday where we dodge the wives, eh?
I feel it in my fingers, I feel it in my toes.
Arthritis.
So I'm going to just do a quick reintroduction very quickly. And then we can do, you all can continue with your conversation. I'm not sure where we ended. But welcome everyone to the Game Changers program. You're joining us here with IBFC, the Independent Black Filmmakers Collective. My name is Maganthri Pillay. I'm one of the co-chairs of IBFC, along with Azania Mwende. We're really excited about this series where we're highlighting the extraordinary work, the difficult work, the game-changing work that people have been doing in our industry, particularly Black filmmakers. And in this particular session, we're having in conversation Bongiwe Selane and Jayan Moodley, who are both feature film producers, and Jayan is also a director. They are filmmakers. Some of them like to be introduced as producers. It's all good. We're so excited to have you share your journeys, which of course have been very challenging, but have also borne fruit. So please do begin your conversation or continue where you've left off so that we can get a little glimpse of some of your journey, some of your lessons, and some of the ways in which you have literally changed the landscape in South Africa in terms of film and television. Thanks very much. Over to you, Bongi and Jayan.
Good afternoon, evening, everybody. I don't think any of us, firstly, is going to forget this meeting because I went through a Zoom meeting being hacked like, boom, boom, what's happening?
Wow. Amazing.
But firstly, I just want to say it's an absolute honor and a real privilege to be a part of today's conversation, be able to be in this room virtually with others as Bongi and I get to talk to each other about the journey in film. Bongi and I think have known each other now for probably around 10 years or so. And as we were sitting and talking about this, we were speaking about all of the things, Bongi, that we have in common. And you know, we were saying we both women of color, we both moms, we both have two kids almost the same age. And I think what really started us on this journey is that we were both recipients, a part of the Black Filmmaker Slate, which was started by the NFBF back in, I think, 2011. So it's so special to be sharing this platform with Bongi because we have this amazing sisterhood that we formed throughout the years. And I just want to know, Bongi, if you can tell us a little bit, how did you get into film? Where did you get this bug?
Oh, yeah, it's it feels like it's been a long time and it's always a bug, I think. I think once you get into this industry, you just want to stay in. And I think Azania Omagantri said it, you always want to make your first film. But yeah, I come from, I suppose I worked at as a commissioning editor for a very long time before the itch to be an independent producer. I did go to film school, but then, you know, worked in a corporation, and around 2011, I decided to be brave enough to enter into the independent producing space. And I was very lucky at the time to have been awarded the Female Filmmaker Slate, which was an incredibly learning curve for me as well. You know, my first big producing job, lots of learning experiences there, but also just an amazing platform where I got a chance to hone my skills and work in collaboration with other women filmmakers, writers, and directors, and be supported within the structure of the NFBF. And yeah, that's really where it started. And I think it's something that I'm really passionate about. And as I grow older and more mature, my passion for it is kind of really looking into being more of a an enabler, I think, you know, because I think there's an exciting new filmmakers that are coming into a space that are really just are so brave with the stories they want to tell, how they're telling them, and just really making us shine on the global space. Yeah.
That's fantastic. And I think I've shared so much of your journey and being a part of it all. And I know firsthand just how passionate you are when you start a project from the beginning until the very end. So if there's one takeaway from Bongiwe, it's, you know, it's just how much of yourself you put into that project. If I think of myself, it's actually a funny story about getting into film, because I think it was around 2009 that SABC started putting out feelers that they're bankrupt. And at that time, most of the work we used to do were TV docus for SABC. And I remember thinking, okay, if SABC is going bankrupt, we have to find a sort of alternate source of income. And that's when I did my first film with a crew of five people, with no funding, with this amazing, beautiful cast, but we just wanted to tell the story. And I think somehow when you throw yourself in the deep end like that, and when you make a low budget, no budget film, the learning process is 100-fold because you suddenly have to do so much. But it was in doing that film that I suddenly realized how much I wanted to tell stories and how much I wanted to make films.
So very interesting. Sorry to interject, but you don't have a filmmaking background. You studied mathematics or something?
Yes, maths and computer science.
Very interesting, yeah.
Yeah, so no film school, but I think we're living in the age where Google and YouTube can teach you a hell of a lot. Mm-hmm. So we shouldn't stop ourselves from wanting to do anything if we can't, or if we haven't gone into film school. You know, the world is really your oyster. So even for all of the producers out there and up and coming filmmakers and emerging filmmakers and you know, even no matter how many films we've made, I think the learning never stops.
Very much so, yeah. And I mean, I know there's a lot to talk about. So Jen and I kind of spoke earlier on about the kind of things we think might be quite relevant for this. But I think as a producer, and I know that I speak about enabling and really kind of playing a kind of a mentor role to upcoming filmmakers. And in the work that we do, we are always confronted with people wanting to send us scripts and wanting to send us ideas just to realize those projects. And we wanted, I wanted to ask you, Jen, what is it that attracts you to a project? And what do you look for when a project is put to you?
Bongi, I think that is so key. Because, you know, you and I are always talking about the number of WhatsApp messages we get and the number of scripts we get sent. And, you know, like you, we've been mentored. You know, we were mentored by Junaid Ahmed and Helena Spring. And we'd love to be a part of that mentoring process for others now that we've been films. But in terms of what attracts us to a project, because firstly, to everyone listening, it's impossible for us to take on every single project. You know, it's impossible for us to do even more than two or three films a year, just because of the pressure and the stress that one goes through with just one film. What attracts me to a project, I've got to fall in love with the story. You know, if I read it, if I read the one-page synopsis, I will say, don't send me a script, just send me a one-page synopsis. There's got to be something in there that just touches my soul, grips me from a story perspective, but that's just from the creative side. Then as producers, there's the business side.
Yeah.
So got to look at it from that perspective and think about whether this can be made realistically within what budget. And then I think the third and most important thing is, do I think this project has the potential to be picked up by someone?
Yeah.
You know, will it be picked up by Netflix? Will it be picked up by Mnet? Will I get funding to do it?
Yeah, yeah. Whether it's appropriate for the current development market, for today's development market, and the financing market, because, you know, you have to kind of think about whether there is an audience, there is a market for the product, and whether there is, you know, that project will be funded, and whether there's an audience for it as well. I think that those are also very much key.
The audience question is huge, because one of the first things that anyone would ask you, whether it's a distributor or an aggregator or someone from the industry, is who are you making this for? You know, who do you think is going to watch this film? So for all of us producers out there, constantly ask ourselves this question. We'd love to make it just for ourselves. We'd love to make it to indulge a little. But at the end of the day, if we're going to be spending that amount of money making a film, the thing for it is wanting to know, you know, who we're making it for.
Yeah.
Speaking of finances, Bongi, as a producer, we often have limited resources and a very restricted budget. From your experience, having done the two films, how do you realistically make it work, purely from a budget perspective?
Look, I think financing is just as important as development. I do think that often the mistake we'd make as filmmakers is to rush a project just because we think the script is locked. But the financing part of it is also incredibly crucial, so that you really understand the deal terms that you're getting into. You understand the risk that you're getting into. We're very fortunate enough, and I don't think we recognize how fortunate we are in the African film marketing, the filmmaking, the continent, how lucky we are that we have a state that supports filmmakers. So, you know, luckily from a development side of things, you know that the NVF is there to kind of, you know, start honing that script with the support of a script editor. We do have the DTIC, and not many, I think we are probably the only country in the continent that has those structures. So it's really just kind of navigating your way around, how do I make sure that my project is ready to be presented to those structures, and being very serious about the fact that you're going to be given funding that you have to use appropriately. And that means being compliant in all aspects of whatever is needed. Obviously, it's taxpayers' money, and it, you know, there's accountability to it. But it's about understanding that the financing element of it also needs time, and that it is out there, but it's how it all fits into like that puzzle almost. And just making sure that you don't fall into the trap of having the process being dictated by someone else. You know, I always find that filmmakers are rushing to make a film because there's a schedule that has to be met, or it has to fit into a particular slot, or the powers might be are saying, oh no, we have to put it on air by this such and such a day. And that often kind of interferes with the financing, because you're just shooting, there's no money in the bank, and then the next thing you realize that, you know, you are in trouble. So for me, that's been quite a learning thing, that I want to be able to go into production knowing that I've put all the elements in place that are going to make the production process and the making of the film easy. There's nothing worse than not sleeping or having stomach ulcers because you're owing the world. You know what I mean? Yeah, I don't know if I've answered your question. It's all over the place, but yeah, just...
In terms of a budgeting perspective, I think you really hit the nail on the head, because I feel the same way, that in South Africa, we want to just go and shoot. And sometimes, and I learned this lesson from the first film that I did, you know, as part of the Black Filmmaker Slate, where the producers had worked out the budget of the film, and they hadn't as yet raised the money. And I was ready. I was like, the script is ready. You know, let's go and shoot. And I remember the producer saying, if we don't have the full amount, we can't shoot. And I thought, we've still got a whack load of money. You know, we can still make this film, you know. And I remember her saying, but if we don't have that full amount, it means we're going to cut corners somewhere. And it means it's going to show in the film. And another lesson that I've learned over the years is that often, if you don't have that full amount, it means, you know, you don't as yet have a pre-license deal, or you haven't been commissioned by a certain powers that be to make your film. And if you don't, it gave me an opportunity to go back and relook at the script, and actually in that instance, rewrite the entire script, like scrap that script, because I kept thinking, well, if it wasn't picked up by this studio, if they may not managing to get funds, maybe the story needs to change. Yeah. And we sent a new script over, and within 2 weeks we had the funds. You know, so sometimes you know, we might want to tell a story, we might be so attached to a story, and we know that that's our voice and we want to keep it true and all of that, but sometimes if we are open to the feedback from others, particularly script editors, commissioning editors, content acquisition managers, if we open ourselves to listening, I think listening is such a great tool. And if we are brave enough to take that criticism constructively, it can actually help us in the long run. It can help our story. It can change our story. But now, for myself, I know when I look back at that first script, I think, ooh, okay. As much as I was sad to tear it up and say no, now I look back and I think, oh, you know what?
I wanna bring it, it's like a personal example for me is that, you know, the first film, Happiness is a Four-Letter Word, was based on a book, obviously. You know, so the adaptation process was kind of, you know, we're going to take story elements from the book, you know, and taking some creative liberties, of course. But the sequel was such a challenge because it wasn't based on a novel. We knew that we had a brand that was very successful, that audiences really responded to, and we wanted to kind of give it more legs, and by giving it more legs was to make a new film that has the heart of the first film, but very different. And the development process was just as long as the first one. I think it was 4 years of developing, but after 2 years, we got to a script that I think I was very ready to finance. I was like, okay, I'm ready now. And it was only when I sent it out, I gave it to someone to read, and they said, you can't make this film. We literally went from third draft scripts back to treatment and literally rewrote it, you know? So, and I think that feedback was so important, and it speaks to the collaboration and the openness that as producers we need to have. I know that sometimes we feel like, oh, this is so precious, I don't want people to see this, but you are making a film for an audience. You are making it for someone else to consume. So why not start there by giving your script to people you know, people you trust to read, to give you feedback. I think that's very, very important. And again, speaks to the importance of collaborating and having other ears, you know, and it's not just in the script, even in the cut where you invite someone to just come and watch the film and ask them if you're hitting the right marks, you know.
I can agree with you more, Bongi, about, you know, particularly at script stage, and it's almost, you got to find your people who you trust.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I know between you and I, we always
one of them for me. Yes, you were one of them for me. Yeah.
Bongi sending me the script for Happiness Ever After and just saying, just have a read. You know, just Jayan, I'm sending it to you, just have a read. And after that, we had a lovely discussion. Mm-hmm. At that point, you know, you do come to when you're developing as producers, particularly if you're a creative producer and you want to get involved right from the beginning, you do have some point where you just feel like you're knocking your head against the wall with the script.
Yeah.
And you don't know what else to change and you don't know what else to do. And that's when you find your people who you trust completely. And exactly as Bongi is saying, don't be afraid to share it with someone you trust. And that goes through right through to, I mean, I know with the three films that we've done, every single one of them had a focus group where I spoke the story to, just said, this is what we're thinking. This is, and I just got different people, you know, age groups. And I just said, what do you think about this? And you'd be surprised how people are so willing to share and become so invested in your story. Besides that, when you have a rough first cut, there is absolutely no harm in showing it to people.
Yeah.
We have a full test screening of about 20 to 25 people. I mean, because, you know, from my side, we do comedy and you want to make sure people are going to laugh and the comedy is going to happen.
Yeah.
And I'm too scared to wait for the movie premiere to see if that's going to happen.
Yeah. You know? So Jayan, tell us, I think this is very important that people want to know, how did you... what was the process you undertook to get your film on Netflix? What was that experience like? Just deciding this is who I want the film to be with.
Okay, so I think more important than me deciding who I want the film to be with, lots of people listening would want to know, how do you get
a
streaming platform like Netflix? So last year, you and I were part of a Women in Film panel that Netflix hosted during Women's Month. And I remember the representative from Netflix said something that really rang true. She said, she gets asked this by everyone, how do you get your film onto Netflix? And she said, there's two things. The first thing is Netflix contacts you. You know, so they approach you because they want you to make a film. So she said, in that instance, it's to your advantage to work with a producer that Netflix knows. So if you must know, with every agency, whether it's Netflix or Mnet or Showmax, every time they make a film, they see it as a business risk. You know, so if there's a producer they trust, they are much more open to listening to that. So that was the first thing she said, go with the producer we know. And the second thing she said was beautiful. She said, make a film and let us notice you. She said, go out and make a film and get our attention. And in my instance, we had just released the second Kandasamy's film. And it so happened that a senior executive from Netflix had watched it on an aeroplane on a flight somewhere in Europe. And that's when they contacted us to say, are you doing a third one? If you are, please, we'd love to have it on Netflix. And then, of course, the business discussion started. And for me, honestly, to have it on Netflix, to have an opportunity to have our small little film from South Africa showcased to 190 countries on the world's biggest streaming platform, it was a no-brainer, you know, for me to go that route. But so the two important things: work with producers that they've worked with before, and go out and make a film. I mean, I made my first film with the crew of five people. So I did art department, wardrobe, hair and makeup. I produced, I directed, I wrote, you know, because you want to, but we still made a film. So so those are the two takeaways that I had from her. That was directly from a representative from Netflix.
No, I remember that. But I think not bad. I think that the fortunate thing for both of us is that we already had films that had done so well. So, you know, like you, you know, there was interest from Netflix that I, that, you know, the sequel sits on the platform, which was very hard. And on a personal note, it was because the first film was supported by MultiChoice, who I used to work for. And, you know, I think there was always that kind of feeling of, oh, they've done so much for me. They gave me my first break. But, you know, to be now confronted with the opportunity to have your film on a global platform, 190 countries, and just very comfortable deal terms that you as a filmmaker feel like you are appreciated and you are worthy and you are, you know what I mean? So it's there, and it's now starting to think about your product and the work that you do from a business point of view, rather than just making a film for the sake of it being released. But what does it mean for your brand and your business going forward? And that's the thing for me is that, you know, we there's so many of us and we're all scrambling for the same piece of pie in the kind of development funding that's available to us. And my mission with my partners is to be able to make a film and from having made that film, make money to develop another film and not be stuck again for 5 years sitting and waiting for the call for development funding from the NVF to submit, you know. That's just the way I want to be able, if there's a project that I'm very attracted to, be able to fund it myself and make that investment. Because once you also make that investment, you're more likely to see it through, you know, because that's your risk here.
Yes, and I think you're absolutely right. I mean, for both of us, we've had very similar experiences in just the way we're treated by Netflix. And respect. I think, you know, we have to make it known and we have to say it, you know, that as people of color, we're not used to that as filmmakers in South Africa. And suddenly we have that, and it was a very, very special experience. But speaking about that and treating people, Bongi, what is one of the most important things for you when we're on set?
I actually don't thrive very well on set. I wear mostly a development producer head. I love being in story rooms. I love the script, reading scripts and giving notes and really interacting with the writer and the script editor. But I know that I have to be on set, you know, for because I have to. It's work. But I think for me, the most important thing, and I guess also the feminine touch that comes with being a woman producer, is I really think it's important for my team and my crew to feel valued, to acknowledge them, you know, to walk on set and acknowledge and see people, like literally see them. There's nothing as beautiful as being seen and recognized for the value you bring into the entire process. And that means greeting them and just treating them with care. One of the most important rules on my set is not to swear. I don't swear. So I don't want anybody to swear at anyone, myself. And I think that, you know, once, if you're starting a production on that first day of principal photography, before you even start rolling, just really instill who you are into the set. And I promise you that kind of filters through to however many months or days or weeks you're shooting. It's very important for me, you know, and it's how I also deal with whatever anxiety might come through, because I feel like if I treat people like that, I know they've got my back as well, you know. Yeah,
I think the element of care is so important, and I'm thinking, you know, when we're on set, you just said something about you don't swear on set, and I'm thinking when anyone swears when I'm on set, they actually apologize to me 9 times out of 10. They look and say, "Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mean it."
Because I've been on sets where people are effing this, effing that, and I'm like, "How do you get up in the morning and come back to this place?"
Someone from crew told me, "It's like, no, because I mother everyone. Like, you know." We always wanted, did you eat? Are you okay? And they're like, we can't swear in front of our mother. But but the taking care of crew and cast, I think, is something we, you know, our industry has to place more focus on. You know, valuing people, we cannot make a film on our own. Besides the fact, just the human element, you know, we're all there, we're working such long hours. And I always think about it, and I think we have a crew of 45 people, and they're all giving me 5 weeks of their life.
Yeah.
All pre-production, just on set, 4 or 5 weeks of their life. They're putting it on hold to come and help me to make a film.
Yeah, and not sleeping, night shoots, all that kind of stuff.
At the very least we could do is just let them know, I think, how much we appreciate having them on set, how much we appreciate their skill, and just how much we appreciate them. Because I think we can forget what a collaboration filmmaking is. There's no one person who can make a film.
Yeah. And I think also, and look, I shot Happiness Ever After during COVID. So that human element was so different to when I shot the first film, you know, that kind of sitting together during lunch and chatting and you know what I mean? Like COVID made it so much more almost inhuman, you know, like, because you become a family, you on set, and you wanna, there's a connection you want. And of course the protocols that were in place where the social distancing and, all that kind of stuff that makes it, well, I mean, I think it's going to be the new way, you know. We're lucky enough that we were able to finish and shoot, having had those rules in place, but it wasn't easy. I don't know what it was like for you, because I missed that. I missed sitting with my HODs and just like, what's happening? And, you know, like, we're all like sitting in corners eating.
It was very difficult, because I think so much of being on set is just about everyone releasing their creative energy, everyone bouncing off ideas from each other, everyone being there for each other. And you just, you sort of ride off that adrenaline of the love from everyone and the ideas from everyone. So all of a sudden, when you have COVID and each department can't interact with another department, you know, you have to sort of keep every department in a bubble because it's safety first. I mean, it really took something away from the filmmaking process, just the enjoyment of that, but it was safety first. We had to keep, you know, everyone safe. But I do tell you that, I can tell you for sure, my heart used to break when I used to see the grips and the lighting guys with those full masks and carrying
heavy, sweaty.
You just be standing or sitting behind the monitor, and I'm already sweating behind that mask. You know, you've got it on the whole day. And I just think, gosh, you know, the sacrifices that everybody's making to help make this film. But I mean, like you and I think we have to be so thankful that we got through our shoots without any incidents shooting during COVID. So it is a new ball game. We do miss that. We're waiting for when we can sit together and have lunch again. With different people and everyone just like laughing and talking. Because now even with a mask, it's so hard to scream. Someone you know, across the room. So it is different. But I think we're making the changes and we're trying our best not to lose that human connection.
I see some questions, but I wanted to just before we go into them, Jen, also just the balancing of family and your work. I know that for myself, I'm lucky enough to I'm a mom and a wife first, that I am a filmmaker, it's very important. And I think that the older my kids have grown, the more demanding it's been. And I know my youngest is in matric this year, which is a big year. It's matric dance. It's like, you know, like all the anxiety that comes with it. But, you know, it's I think for me, it's really just making sure that I have a tribe. I have a support structure from my husband, but also my mom and just friends who come in and step in when I need help, when I have to be away for a while, or when I have to, luckily we don't travel as much as we do when the festival circuits were on, but when you're shooting and developing, you're in the office until like midnight, literally doing pre-production or even in post.
Yeah, I think for me, it's you know, people always ask me, how do you balance family and work? And I always say that balance means it's a balancing act. For me, there's no balance. Family's priority.
Mm-hmm.
No matter what, you know, I am a mom first. You know, we always talk about it, you and I, about our kids. Yeah. Only age. My daughter's
teenagers.
And in the 20s. And so it's family first, because being a filmmaker, being a producer is very challenging. It's very difficult. It really is blood, sweat, and tears. And for me, having that priority where my family comes first, no matter what, has helped me find who I am so that I can be a producer. Okay. And more than that, when I am producing a film, I know that no matter what, the one person who has my back is my husband. Mm. You know?
Yeah.
You and I both know, when you're married, you are taking on this huge financial risk making a film. Everybody mm-hmm. else paid, your cast and your crew. But if anything happens, Bongi, the buck stops with us. We are the one accountable at the end for that 5 million budget, 8 million budget, 12 million budget. But we also must remember, it's not just us taking that risk. It's our families with us.
Yeah.
So if our families are going to be taking this huge risk with us, and if they're going to have our back and be this amazing support structure, I think that's the first sort of starting building block where you and I both know we could not have done this on our own.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I know for myself, just having that family support, I know when I'm on set, I never have to worry about taking care of the family, because every auntie or cousin or whatever is cooking food and sending over to my house. So, you know, as you said, you need a tribe, you need a community, you need support, Yeah.
But I want to speak a little bit about that support, even within what we do, within the kind of filmmaking space. It's you know, it took me a long time to grapple with the idea that there's certain things I don't like doing.
Sure.
As a producer. Like, I really like, yeah, I just don't want to do them. There's places where I thrive, and there's places where it just gives me so much anxiety, you know. And I've been very lucky this past 2 years to really have partnerships and that I've formed that have really supported me to excel in what I do. And it's something that I really want a lot of filmmakers to start thinking of, because there's so much, you know, there's so many pieces that you have to put into this puzzle. And it's about you finding the right people that will help you go to that, you know, walk that vision with you and get to it.
You know, Bongi, finding the right team is critical. Mm-hmm. Surrounding, I call it the A team. I say you mm-hmm. got to surround yourself with the A team. And I think both you and I feel the same way, even about surrounding ourselves with the A team. Like this third film that I produced, I brought in a co-producer, woman of color, and it was her first time co-producing, and she was amazing. I don't think she slept for the 5 weeks. She just went, and for me, just to see someone like that, firstly grow. Secondly, having my back, it just makes you realize that if you have people who you know you can rely on, if you're thinking of something and you phone her and say, hey, Indrani, did you think? And she's like, sorted. I already thought about that yesterday.
Yeah.
So surround yourself with the right team is key. And then, of course, transformation in the industry. Transformation as producers. When we were not producers, we could always look from the outside and say, when is there going to be transformation in the industry? When are there going to be more Black people employed as part of crew? But Bongi, now that you and I wear the producer hat, we have to be
intentional. It's about intention. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, and I must say, for me, my proudest moment on set was just to have two white people, the entire crew. I was like, yeah, I did it, you know? And I'd phone around, they'd be like, oh, there's no one who can do that who's Black. I'm like, really? You go out and find them. You know what I mean? Like, it's really about being intentional about, because we can talk it, but if we don't do it,
I started off, I know the third one, saying over 80% of the crew has to be Black. It was, as you said, the intention was there, but besides just the intention, it was non-negotiable. I think at about 84-85%, and I was thrilled. And you know, just to, when we talk transformation and we're part of all of these workshops, it's one thing, but when we start to live it and we start to see it in action, it's another thing. It's so special, I think, to be a part of this time in our history. To do that.
Jayan, I think there's some questions. I know my Guthrie was going to read them, but I'm not sure how we're doing with time. But there's, thank you guys for this talk. Bongiwe, can I please ask, how does IP work with adaptations? Do you
mind? We're doing okay. So
we're doing okay. Okay, great.
Sorry,
I think,
so you know what?
Mm-hmm.
I think, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you. We can hear you.
Oh, great. Excellent. So I think the two questions are very similar, and it has to do with, and this is to Bongi specifically, how did you negotiate that adaptation process? There's a question before that, why this book? So there's why this book, but then there are two questions related to IP and negotiating IP before you even start the writing process.
Okay.
So I also just wanted to say, obviously, this is a whole seminar, adaptation and IP. So I think just do a summary. And I think this is a great future conversation, is looking at the whole adaptation process from different angles. So I just wanted to say, let's just give people an insight, and let's put this on the table for a later conversation as well.
I completely
more
agree.
In depth. So we have 15 minutes.
Okay.
We have 15 minutes just to, for whatever questions there are. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I think it would be a worthwhile webinar to talk about adaptation and the process and all that, but just to briefly, I loved the book Happiness is a four-letter word when it came out. It came out, I was working at Mnet. It won, they used to run these literary awards at Mnet where they awarded great South African literary work. And Happiness is a four-letter word, won a book most suited for adaptation. And I think at the time when that literary award happened, I was also itching to be an independent producer. And it was part of my exit strategy to say, I'm going to go and take a risk and be this independent producer, but this is probably going to be the first film I ever make. And I was lucky enough to pitch it to the Black Filmmaker Slate, to Junaid Ahmed, and was brought into that stable that saw Hard to Get Made, The Kandasamis, Keeping Up with the Kandasamis, and Happiness is a four-letter word. And the process there was that I contacted the author. I said, I love this book. I think it reads incredibly visually. And then optioned it from NB Publishers for 2 years, which is really just kind of optioning is booking a book for a fee that it's you to give you time to develop it, So it's the option process first, which is can be a year to a 2 year period. Usually if you want to extend it, because sometimes it could take longer, you just have to pay more. And then once you're ready to shoot it and there's a script and you're financing it, you do have to enter into a film agreement, which is basically buying the rights from the publisher and the author. That's really the process. It's really just the negotiations and dealing with the publisher to get the rights to the book, yeah. The first part is the optioning, and then it's the film rights process. Yeah, I hope I answered the question.
And I think the other person, I just wanted to acknowledge as well, I can't see, I wrote, Minenhlile Luthuli, thank you both. Before we continue, I think a lot of people may not understand what an actual breakthrough that Black Filmmaker Slate was for South African film and historically, because Happiness is a four-letter word was the first film to break the 10 million rand barrier outside of Leon Schuster. So that was huge. It also showed us that there was an audience for films with Black women as protagonists. So I think that was just a breakthrough. And the game, obviously we're talking to you because you're the game changers. And of course, Keeping Up with the Kandasamis broke the 18 million rand barrier. And I'm not sure where the numbers are at now. I'm dying to know, what is that? You know, where is it in terms of all the other sales and all of that? But before that, the average South African film made 300,000 rands at the box office. And I think this is what a lot of people do not understand, what an actual breakthrough both these films and the subsequent films you've made. So I just wanted to add some history in here because a lot of people don't know. And of course, we all miss Junaid, who was a mentor to you both and a mentor to myself as well. And then there's other questions that have come up. There's a question about the Netflix deal. There's a couple of questions and I'm going to put both these in. Was it a licensing deal? Was it partly funded? And do you get royalties? I think those are very interesting questions. So that's the one question. And there is another question around when you are working with a bigger platform, is what kind of freedom do you have? Or is the concept then tailor-made to the platform? So just talking a little bit about that process. So licensing, the funding, royalties, but also in terms of the creative process and the IP and working with Netflix in terms of independence, control, conversation, you know, working with them in terms of their platform. Thanks.
So in
and
my
that's instance, to both of you.
Okay. In my instance, it was a license, happiness is happiness ever after, sorry. So with Netflix, it is a license for a particular period of time. So it's not on their platform forever and ever. And within that time, obviously, they've paid for the license fee already. So there's no royalties on that. But when that time lapses, and I think it's 7 years, the rights revert back to myself and my partners, who will then be able to sell it on to other platforms and public broadcasters and those kind of things. And really that's, you know, you can strike a different deal. If you want your film to be commissioned, there's nothing wrong with the film being paid for fully by a platform and they own it. You just, you know, just negotiate that you're paid reasonably well to live with that, you know. But in my instance, yeah, it was a pre-sale. I haven't done a film with Showmax, but with Mnet, again, the decision to go with Netflix was because the deal terms that Netflix presented on the table were much sweeter. So it was a business deal. It was a business decision. And you know, we were in the middle of a pandemic. I didn't want to take the risk of having a theatrical release and risking that. And I felt like being a sequel, the audience and the fans will find it on Netflix. You know, I didn't really have to go to the, which the Mnet deal required me to have a theatrical release.
Mm-hmm. And then obviously you also had a wider and a newer audience. Absolutely. That had access to your film as well.
Absolutely. And you know, it was so nice to see the results that the film was like a top 10 in Honduras. Who would have thought my film would be top 10 in Honduras, in Israel, in the Caribbean, in, wow, you know, Costa Rica. I was like, wow, this is so nice. I was getting texts from people saying, I'm a filmmaker from the diaspora. I want to make a film with you. I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm going to go to Costa Rica. No, not really. But well, yeah, it's a global platform. That's base.
Yes. And you know, the story that we've been told by lots of people, investors. I remember this 10 years where they were always telling us that nobody was interested in our stories and nobody was interested in Black stories. And the beauty perception, and you're now creating a new reality. It's so exciting. Wow. Jayan, do you want to respond to that question?
Yeah. I think in terms of the deal, it was very similar to Bongi. It's a pre-licensed deal. Of course, everything else about the negotiation is confidential and the contract. But it's just so heartwarming to see Netflix coming in and saying, we want your local content. We want, how do they say it? You know, stories with local flavor and universal themes and international appeal. So from that perspective, the deal is, it can be a commissioned or a licensed deal. I think both Bongi and I, you know, these projects are like our babies. It was our first one. Mm. And maybe we held on to a licensed deal a little more. But more than that, the second question was about how involved is Netflix and how much of creative freedom do you have when making the film? I can speak from my experience. And you send the script in, you might get some notes. But with me, because it was the third film, I remember they said, you know your formula, you know what works, you're not going to mess too much with it. You give your audience what they want. And I'm pretty sure with Bongi, you know, being the sequel as well, it was very nice to have that element of trust and to have them give us that creative freedom to just, you know, go on and just make our films.
Yeah. I mean, I think for me, the you know, it was really like so refreshing to be in a room. And when I say room, Zoom has been in our rooms now where we present and we pitch, to be so respected and treated with so much, I guess respect is the word, you know, and being made to feel like you're part of the team, like you're contributing, you are also giving something. And it was such a different experience to local broadcasters, where I always feel like I'm always scared, and I always think if I make a mistake, oh my gosh, it's my problem. And, you know, whereas the collaborative space that, and the support that they gave you, that if there was a problem, it wasn't Bongi's problem, it was how do we fix it? How do we collectively fix it? And so that just made the whole, it makes you want to win. You know, you want to win. You don't want to make these people look bad when they're treating you like this. You know what I mean? With so much, yeah.
Bongi, which I think you and I have spoken about before, is about how we're not made to feel like they're doing it. It's like we're in this together. It's
thank you. Mm-hmm.
So that was a lovely working experience.
Yeah.
Lovely. Before you go on, I just wanted to also say, around Netflix, they consider a film or a series a success if it does well locally. If it doesn't do well locally, they don't actually consider it a success. So I think that, you know, those are things you have in your favor as well. And a lot of people who imagine that everything has to be universal, normally universal excludes the local engagement. So you both have demonstrated a high local appeal, and therefore also a global appeal. So it's just exciting. We do have another question about, we have a couple of questions around negotiating and working with people who don't have your back. And how do you actually, also has to do with when you have a project that is not getting support, do you leave the project? I mean, when do you say, hey, we got to move on? So I think those two are not exactly similar, but they're interesting in terms of dealing with negative situations. But we're not going to close on that point, so we must come back. So if you guys want to, anyone want to respond to that?
Can you? Bongi, do you want to go?
So the question is, at what point do you give up a project? You know, I that is a reality. My answer to it is there's always another project. You know, I think there is a time where, and I have one that I'm passionate about, that I know that there's going to be a time where I let it go, just because, you know, I think films and stories have relevance at a particular point, at a particular time. You might have the story that you spent years developing, and in my case, it's traveled film labs all over the place. My director and I have development fatigue from it. And I think that comes from all the labs internationally that have had their eyes on it, that just, and you know, the input and the notes we've received have kind of put us in a place where we're thinking, what's this film? We never set out to make this film, you know? And I think it's when you have a project and you're developing it, you need to constantly ask yourself whether you're still making the same film that you set out to make, and continue to ask yourself whether it has an audience, whether this is financeable, you know, whether it will get the attention of funders and platforms and distributors and sales agents, you know. And if you don't have those answers, and or they, at least they're vague, you must know that it's time to move on, you know. I'm at that stage. I think I'm moving on, but I've been
heartbreaking, but
yeah, it happens. It happens, but there's always another
one. You have to know. Yeah. You have to know when it's time to let go. Jayan, Do you want to respond to that question, or do you want to respond to the question around when people are not in your corner and how do you negotiate that?
I think making a film is so challenging, and making a film is such hard work already before we even step onto set. We've already waged war, you know, getting the finances in order, checking up on the legal thing, drawing up the budget, the scheduling, just the mind mess in here already before you step on set is already, it's huge. So when you get on set, for me, if someone is not playing ball, if someone is not just being polite, not adding to an atmosphere on set that is conducive to good work and respecting each other, I'm sorry, but I'll give the person a second chance, but after that, they have to be let go. Mm. Because ultimately, that one person's energy is going to rub off person number two, person number three, person number four, and suddenly you have an entire unhappy, nasty crew. You just need people to all be there with you every day. You going on set, you are having a call time of 5 a.m. You're going to work the entire day. Every day you're going through this. You can't have that on set.
Yeah. And activity is contagious. I think I always find that on set or in any,
you've got to pick your crew very carefully. And I personally interview them. You know, I remember I was interviewing someone for second AD, a young guy, and he said, oh, in my last one, they made me carry boxes. I'm not part of art department. And I remember thinking, oh, in making a film in South Africa, we all got to carry boxes.
I'm not hiring you. And make coffee.
Yeah, but it is important to keep that energy positive, you know, all the time.
Yeah.
Bongiwe, Selane, Jayan, Moodley, you guys have changed the game. You've all, created work that has changed the South African industry. You're icons to many people. We all want to be like you when we grow up. thank you so much for all the work that you've done and that you will continue to do. We are coming to 6 o'clock. I just love that you also both have so much in common, and that you share the road together. I think that's really beautiful. And just in terms of the Independent Black Filmmakers Collective, we're so honored that you were part of this conversation and that you're both members. Woohoo! thank you so much for your time and for your insight and sharing your experiences. I don't know if you just want to wrap with any last minute, last words. Advice, just final advice to people who sit on the road to being producers and going on this extraordinary journey of making movies to close.
You know, I mentioned that I literally have a tribe and people that I've adopted as my brothers and my sisters, and it really has kind of made me realize, and maybe it's not a realization, it's just the reality of the fact that I don't make films alone. There's no way I can do what I do alone. And so my advice would be to for people to collaborate. Obviously, it's not always going to. Sometimes we're drawn to projects and that collaboration becomes automatic because you just want to be part of this project. But also just to know that, and this is what's exciting for me with IBFC, is the platform to know that there's someone who's going to fight my battles on a bigger scale, you know, lobbying for my films or what I need, and just having this access to this knowledge that we can all tap into, and really not being kind of shy about asking, you know, the other, being vulnerable. You know, Brené Brown talks about vulnerability, and we always think of it as a weakness, but it's not. It's really asking and getting people to tick the boxes that you might not be able to tick. And I just want to give a shout out to Unati Malunga from from SASFED, who's actually a dear friend, but who really helped me tick the boxes when I was renegotiating the rights to Happiness is a Four-Letter Word, making a sequel, and really looking at what the potential for all these other rights that I could have that I would never even have thought of. And that's why that webinar on film adaptations and rights is something that we should really think very hard on. But yeah, collaborate, ask questions, be vulnerable, and just allow yourself to let people in, you know, into your work.
Wonderful, thank you. That's just so beautiful. Jayan?
Yeah, I think all of us here are living in such exciting times in South Africa. If you think about 10 years ago, there were almost no opportunities to be able to create content and to be able to make films or develop series. So I think, you know, to everyone out there, to take hold of this exciting time, work hard, you know, have that determination, that dedication, keep the passion and just keep going. We might get told no many times, but that yes is going to come. You know, if you keep going and you keep applying and you keep coming up with different stories. So I think especially for the youth out there, you know, our young filmmakers, you guys have so many opportunities. Learn about all of these opportunities. Mm. Attend whatever workshops you can. You have access to the internet and that can teach you anything. You know, don't stop that process of just going. And for someone who asked, you know, when do you give up on a project? I think about myself, I've got 5 projects in sort of development at the moment. And whether they're going to get made or not, you don't know. But I don't think you ever really give up on a project. You know, as Bongi says, you might have fatigue. Project fatigue.
Yes. You know, I'm there.
But I don't think you ever give up on it until, I don't know. So even if you have however many projects, and even if you're feeling like, you know, it's not going to get made, don't give up. Ask one more person to read it. Ask and someone else for their input. Open it up a little. And you never know. You never know what sort of feedback you're going to get. But find the people that you trust. Don't walk this path alone.
Yeah.
It could be very sad and very lonely if you even think about trying to do that.
Yeah.
And being part of story rooms and being part of groups and being part of, I mean, it's just like Bongi and I, if we're just having coffee together and we can just start talking ideas and you know, find those people. Find those people that you trust, who you gel with, who you have some sort of synergy with. And it just makes the journey all the more enjoyable.
That's nice. Yeah, that's true.
And we really hope that people will join us on our upcoming Game Changers series. Look out for them and let's try and be more secure and safe. Although, how does one do that? We'll attempt it. Thank you very much for your insights and your experiences and sharing that with us. We really appreciate it. And for those of you who are joining us who are not yet IBFC members, please go to our website and join. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you for, it was an honor, really. And I hope that the series kind of grows and I'll be logging in to listen to other inspiring conversations.
Yes, thank you everyone for joining. It really was lovely.
And can I just say thanks very much to also the behind the scenes team who have held it all together. We really appreciate Tunde and Nomsa and Ramadan. Thanks very much for holding this together and making sure we're all on track. Thanks,
guys. Thank Bye, everyone.
Thank you, everybody. Thanks Bye. For joining, and thanks for the questions.
Bye.